や。
Are you working your way through every African country? Is that your plan now? You're going Kenya.
It just gets under your skin being there.
Yeah,
I love Africa. I mean, I'd been there as a student, and then, you know, doing the backpacking thing. But being in Kenya, that was just a fantastic year. You know, it was brilliant. I loved it. Being in the middle of those mountains with that community who were all involved in the film. In the end, I had the whole school was involved, their mums, dads, aunties, all the shopkeepers, all the people from the local area, everybody was included in that. And it just, that film led to Mandela, really. It went to play in South Africa. And one of the financiers, producers on it, Anand Singh, he started talking to me about doing Long Walk to Freedom. I was like, I can't do Long Walk to Freedom. How can you even do that? You know, it's a massive book. Great documentaries have been made about Mandela. And he said, I'll come to South Africa. Come and, you know, and he was showing my film, First Grader. And he'd invited a lot of the family and some of the comrades and some of the men and women that were part of the story. And I just was talking to them. And I ended up spending a couple of weeks and through those conversations is that I saw this way into the making of the film and this personal take about Mandela as a man. These were people that knew him personally and had been either in prison with him on B-Wing with him, mm-hmm. Winnie or the two daughters or the jailers, the guards, the interrogators. I managed to have these, and Ant had written to Mandela while he was in prison. So for the subsequent years, he'd formed these relationships which I had access to, and that kind of really gave me an in. And also, I just love the energy from the place. I don't know if you have you been? Have you been to Johannesburg? Oh, it's just the people are just extraordinary. I mean, you can feel the history, but there is this energy, this pulsing energy throughout the country that's just beautiful. Beautiful. So that was really, I mean, yeah, I mean, and I'm happy to go back to Africa and shoot something else, but yeah, that was 3 years. Great. It was a fantastic experience.
So was it, I mean, that entryway in, you had figured out that part of it, but I mean, it's still a massive story. What was the process like of trying to figure out where this would all go, how you were going to squeeze this all into actually a two-hour tale?
It was those relationships, really. It was the family. It was the family and the comrades, and just there was a point, I can't remember exactly when, but the way in, I think it was in Victor Verster actually, which was the last prison, which is in Cape Town, which is the last prison that Mandela was held in. And I was in there remembering when I was a student in Manchester him coming out of prison, and I was talking about it. I was going, why, you know, no one knew what he looked like. Do you remember? It was like, we were waiting for ages for him to come out. And I was there with all my college mates. And I was saying to this guard who was there on the day, who was showing us around the prison, I said, what was it? What was the score? You know, what were we waiting for? And he was going, oh, he would not walk out without Winnie. He would not walk out. And everywhere I started to go, I then started to have these personal stories about his relationship with Winnie and this power of this relationship that they had. And I saw Winnie and how she was with children, and I saw the children, and I saw how they were with their own children. And Ahmed Kathrada, who was on the same B wing, had said, on the very first night I was in South Africa, he'd said that the one thing that they were robbed of was hearing, or even, you know, just for 27 years not hearing a child. When I think about my own children, not seeing them for a day, it's painful, but to not hear a child for that amount of time. So I started to think about the cost to the man, and maybe there was an approach, you know, as much as the story and his life charts like the 100-year history of apartheid, is that this could be a film that dealt with love and the cost to the man and the cost to him as a dad and the cost to him as a husband. And I think that resonated with the people that I was talking to, and so these personal stories started coming out. And so me and Bill, it was great for Bill and I, because we had a kind of fresh take on it. And I think Bill had been involved with Anand with a few other directors, and but this the love story, that was the that would be the through line for us, and as much as it was about apartheid, it would be a film about love and forgiveness, you know.
But one of the things that's canny about the film is what it doesn't have in it, and that it's, you know, that it doesn't get too far into the soup at times. I mean, you feel the story, you feel the history, it works beautifully, but it's also, you know, for instance, there's not a ton of Winnie off, you know, off the other tracks that Winnie got onto while he was in jail and things like that. A lot of those conversations, the kind of the will not to do that is interesting to me.
Well, in the early days, I met a documentary filmmaker who, as Mandela came out of prison, Angus Gibson, he's called, he'd made he'd shot with Mandela a documentary for, I think, for like 4 or 5 years. And I had an evening with him, and he was talking about Mandela being the Mandela was on Robben Island for 27 years while the country descended into complete and utter, I mean, it was a bloodbath. I mean, it just descended into madness. And I've seen footage that would, and did this very, very disturbing of those times. And he said that was one of the reasons why Mandela was able to, you know, he went into prison with a set of principles. Mm-hmm. He was almost put on ice those 27 years as everything escalated in Soweto, everything in the rest of the country. And there's Winnie on the outside in amongst it as it kind of descends into complete chaos. And that felt very, very interesting. You know, this man who had a set of beliefs, and we all kind of think, oh, prison must have changed. He didn't. People came to Mandela, you know, the world came to Mandela. He didn't change his viewpoint or his politics or the way or his beliefs. I mean, I'm sure they honed their ideas, those men. But that felt a very, very interesting. On the one hand, you had Winnie, who's living amongst it in Soweto, and on the other, you've got Mandela, who's in prison with those men. It was one of the things that, you know, the comrades all were talking about, is that, you know, and I was kind of, how can you still have this forgiveness? How can you, with everything that happened and everything that you lost as men? And you know, Eddie Daniels and Ahmed Kathrada would always talk about the women in amongst it, had it harder in a way. I mean, Robben Island is a very, very tough, bleak place, but they talked about the women on the outside of it. And that felt right for the film. Is, you know, and we you know, a film. How, I mean, I was embarrassed, you know, to talk to Winnie Mandela to try and say we're reducing this into a film and reducing this into a 2.5 hour experience, you know. Mm-hmm. But we can't cover everything. You can't in a movie, can you? You just can't. You just have to try and be true to the point of view. And the cost of the man was the through line for us.
Mm. Well, I mean, you can't do everything. That's absolutely true. But it's interesting. It's like, it doesn't feel like a travelogue through the life of Nelson Mandela and Winnie Mandela. It does feel like a whole.
I hope so. I hope it feels true to them and true to their struggle. And there was one parameter for the film, which was, although there was incredible freedom, I mean, the Mandela family are behind the movie and the foundation gave me access to the archive, but at no point did anybody say, oh, you have to do this or you show this. And I was talking about showing him as a flawed man and showing Winnie as a flawed woman. Mm-hmm. And that felt very, very important to us, you know, making the movie. But the one thing that we had to do with the movie is it was his long walk to freedom. So it had to be from him as a boy to him as an older man. You know, mm-hmm. That felt right. But also, I was very conscious that it's an independent African movie, financed out of South Africa. Mm-hmm. With, you know, I know I was an honorary South African at the time when I was making it, but, you know, there was hundreds of men and women that were making this film, and it's a South African film, and we had to, you know, we're making a movie that is representing those people's lives, so it had to be true and real and visceral, and also, you know, at the same time, be a movie that would stand in the cinema. I mean, That was a massive thing for all of us, is that we were making an independent movie, but we wanted the car chases and the action to feel visceral and real, and to for you to engage with these characters, and to for it not to be the kind of usual kind of period, you know, where there's a veneer between you and what you're watching. And that was the approach in terms of how we made it, as was to try and drop the audience in amongst it, to be real 360 degree worlds. If we were going into Soweto, use Sowetan people, have them employed in front of them, behind the camera, make sure they're part of the crowd. The crowd are a huge part of the movie. So there's no escape for an actor playing Walter Sisulu or Nelson Mandela or Winnie Mandela. They're walking onto stages where women and men have lived and are living the struggle today, you know. So they might be open-hearted, brilliant, warm people, but there's no way that they're going to take an untruth. So Idris standing in front of them had to be right on it. And that immediate, visceral kind of way of filmmaking felt appropriate to kind of what we were doing, you know, that in a... The multiplex is so full of, CGI and movies that are about superheroes. There may be a room, I mean, touch wood, for a movie that is about a different kind of superhero, maybe.
So the casting is a key part of that whole piece of how you covered history.
Yeah, well, without your Mandela in the movie, that was, for all I was talking about it, making it feel 360 degree worlds and visceral and immediate and right. in amongst it, it would have been nothing without Mandela. And the producers who'd been on it for a little while, a few years, when they had a kind of certain idea of who it was going to be, as you can imagine, great actors, but... I started talking to him right from the off, because I knew Idris, and I had a couple of friends that had worked with Idris and said that they had an instinct that me and him would get on, and I loved him from The Wire. And I started talking to the producer, said, listen, Idris Elba. They're going, who? I mean, we think about Idris Elba now because we've seen all his movies and stuff, and there's a lot happened in the 3 years that, you know, we started first talking about casting this. And but to their credit, they let me get on a plane and go and meet him, and I spent 3 days with Idris. Talked to Idris about the way I was going to approach it in terms of we were using South African real locations, 360 degree sets with people in there, real prison guards, real prisoners on the island, but we weren't doing an impression or an impersonation of Mandela. This was going to be an exploration of him as a man. And Idris is a Londoner, you know. He's not from the Eastern Cape. He doesn't look anything like Mandela. He's exactly the same height, though. And
wider, I think.
Well, Mandela was a boxer, you know. I mean, he was a boxer. He was very. I mean, there are a few photographs of Madiba before he went into prison. He was a big guy, you know. He was a big, fit guy. He trained every day. He boxed. He was a heavyweight boxer. So, you know, we think of Mandela as when he came out of prison. He lost a lot of weight during prison. I mean, he trained every day in prison, boxed in prison. So he came out as a leaner man. But as a younger man, he was much heavier set. And Idris, that approach chimed for Idris. And as much as it was it was going to be a film about... about him as a political leader, we wanted to try and scratch underneath the surface of that and explore him as a man. So as much as we kind of read and watched, you know, the DVDs or documentaries, and there's great footage about Mandela, it was really important for Idris. Like, I'd been there listening and watching and observing and living in the country. For Idris to come to the country and understand him culturally, where he came from, understand his Corsa heritage, understand him as a man, and that for Idris was as important as reading around it and watching it. It was actually being there and soaking up the where Mandela had come from, and so that he didn't get kind of bogged down with this voice or this impression of this man.
Did you have any concerns about him aging up to the degree to which he had to?
Well, I thought I had an instinct that he's such a subtle actor, Idris, but I had an instinct that he would catch him as a young man. Mm-hmm. I mean, I knew people that had gone. Obviously, we know Mandela was a brilliant lawyer, and he was. But I got to meet people that had been out partying with him. Knew he loved fast cars. Knew he loved clothes. Knew
fast
he loved women. Yeah, and So but the overriding thing that we all talked about was him as a star. You know, he's a star. He'd walk in a room and you could feel him, you know, the energy coming off him. I met him when he was 90, just before his 94th birthday, and he was like the electricity that came off him. So what he must have been like as a young man. And Idris is certainly a star. You meet Idris, he's got something very warm, very, very immediate about him. Because there wasn't the level of photographic evidence or images of Mandela as a young man, mm-hmm. I thought if audiences could accept him, Idris, as a young man, and see Mandela, the boxer, it's a take of him that we might not know from the history books. The elder, I was more concerned with, because that would require prosthetics, and then might be a barrier between mm-hmm. the audience and totally believing. But it was that first day we had a helicopter, and I'd managed to persuade the producers to give me a helicopter for a day, and it was like for that action sequences where the car chase, and mm-hmm. then at the end of the day I used the helicopter for the very, very last shot of the film. That was the first time we'd seen him in the. Apart from the screen test, is the first time we've seen him in the prosthetics, and that shot just before the sun went down, I had absolutely no doubt. You know, the walk and everything, and I was with the pilot of the helicopter that had knew Mandela, and we both were like, wow. As we were getting close, I mean, his walk and his gait and the way he was in the landscape was brilliant. And then Anand took that shot and showed Madiba, and he was, is that me? So that for me and Idris was like, oh, great, we've got now, we can go forward and know that, you know, we're being true.
So as a director, are you terribly nervous up until that point, till it actually does come to life in front of you, that Idris is going to become Mandela to that degree?
Well, that's the hardest bit. I mean, the hardest. I knew that he had the warmth. I knew he was a star. I knew he had the intelligence and the dynamism as a character. And I'd also known, just because I'd been with him in the research, and we you know, that he'd really scratched underneath the surface of it, and to catch his voice and his intonation as a man from the Eastern Cape was very, very important, and he got that. But yeah, that was the very, very final thing, because when you think of Mandela, we think of him as this older man, don't we? We think about that. That's why how my children view him, as their grandfather. So to get that right, to get that walk and that, but also it's not a Mandela trained in prison, mm-hmm. all through those prison years, those 27 years. The footage of Mandela that I'd seen, he comes out in his 70s, he's like there, he's on it, he's just, he's so fit, he's so alive. And that's not a man, a younger man playing an older man. Right. You know, there's a certain energy with Mandela. You see him with de Klerk and all those guys when all of that shit's going on in the country. And that was the shocking thing for me, was I'd been at college, and I remember him coming out. Mm-hmm. I hadn't realized just quite what a bloodbath that was, and how he and those men and women managed to turn it round. I mean, the country was descending into freefall, and how he managed. But then you see him in that footage, and he's alive. I mean, he is alive. He is so energetic. He's like a young man. He leaves all those other men standing, you know, the way
he was
physically.
There is a difference between the, you know, our Morgan Freeman version of Mandela and what that looks like in our head, tall, wide, but not, you know, but older.
Yes.
Idris.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, when I saw footage, I guess, or whatever they showed in Cannes, and I was like, oh no, it's going to be, you know, I mean, I love both actors.
I'm a Morgan Freeman. He's
already,
stunning actor.
But I was already like, you know, okay, it's Mandela, he fights, he fucks. That's the movie they're making, but it's not the movie you made.
No.
That's you know, part of the first act.
Yeah, and that, you know, that's the whole point. You know, the whole point of the story is that it was something that we all talked about, is show him as a man. I mean, Mandela, as himself, wants to be seen as a man. And, you know, I mean, isn't that when you're making a story about his life, particularly from his book, you want to show all sides. And flaws as well as the brilliant, wonderful things, but also the flawed nature of him, because that makes him a human being. I mean, Mandela wants to be like you and me. You know, he is like you and me. He's a man who's had relationships, is a father, is a husband, has been a husband, that felt very, very important. But that also felt, if you're gonna, if you're gonna make a film, a dramatic film that holds in the cinema, I mean, yes, the action sequences and the visceral nature of it all, but it has to have a point of view. I mean, it has to have a point of view. And that felt to me important, that the cost to the man, the human being behind it. And because I had this amazing access to people that had been close to him, who talked about him, we might be able to explore something that's behind closed doors, you know, to hear the daughters talking about when they were left on their own and they're making stuff with, bread and milk, and their mum's being taken away. I mean, it's just those little stories felt as though that could personalize it and give you hope, really. Basically give you hope.
So you would think it would be scary to put some of those things on film, because obviously the conversations between him and Winnie are not transcribed somewhere, nor how he treated his kids when he comes home or things like that. And yet you had the sureness because you had people who told you those things.
Yeah, correctly. I mean, obviously it's you're making a film about Mandela, and you and I'm from Manchester, you know,
right.
It's like, you know, so the one thing I just held was to be true and honest, mm-hmm. and as honest and as true as I could, not to tell any lie. Yes, we'd have to kind of segue through certain bits of history. Mm-hmm. We could not show the whole thing,
right.
But to be detailed, to be honest with it, to be even-handed in terms of, you know, we show the first wife, how difficult that relationship was. That was a tempestuous relationship, you know. Winnie Mandela, we show a side of Winnie Mandela that I don't think people have seen. I mean, I grew up with Western press in England, you know, making her out to be in many respects a monster, you know, in terms of never once did they talk about her being a mother. And I saw footage when I was down there of Winnie Mandela, nine rolls of 16mm film that had been shot by an American film company, I think, just to this young woman just out of prison, 17 months solitary confinement. And you see Winnie Mandela, how she's over her children and her grandchildren and her great-grandchildren, to be ripped out of her home at 23 and to be put in solitary confinement, not knowing where her children were, you know, and living in amongst it in the eye of what was going on in Soweto. So it felt like that not everything that I heard obviously went into the film, but the some of the truth, I hope, and all of the truth, kind of, I hope it's true, and certainly that was the response I got last Sunday when we took it to Soweto and we took it to Johannesburg and showed it to the family and the people that had helped us make it, is that they felt it was true.
Well, it's funny because I guess the comparative is some way Peter Morgan, who does all these films where there are historic characters who he has a lot of research and a lot of detail, but there are, you know, big passages of dialogue that are somewhat invented by Peter. I mean, I think Peter's brilliant, but it feels like a different kind of biographical energy than the scenes between, say, you know, intimate scenes where they're determining how they're going to live after he comes out of the prison, for instance.
Yes.
Where, you know, as I say, nobody's saying to you, okay, these are the exact words he said, this is how he turned, how he did, but yet you caught a spirit.
Yes.
That you feel comfortable is true because you spoke to enough people who were...
Yeah, who were there.
Who were there.
Who heard the argument. I mean, yeah. I'd not imagined that Mandela would shout.
Right.
You know what I mean? You just don't, do you? You don't think about Mandela having a real... But he's strong. I mean, he's strong and he's forthright with his opinion. And you know, I'd heard, you know, and there's moments in the movie where he, as an older man, not this is not him as a young man, but as an older man, is very strong, very, very determined, and very determined to go down his path.
So those screenings you were talking about a few minutes ago, the most nerve-wracking of all?
That was the most nerve-wracking. Can you imagine? You're in Johannesburg. You're in with Winnie Mandela, the women, the Mandela household, people that have been with Mandela 30 years, you know, people who are all around him and the daughters. And I'm with my own children, my own family, my own wife's there, and we're all watching the movie, and some of them had seen it before, and I'd been making a few adjustments and stuff up until that screening, and yeah, that was a very, very powerful, overwhelmingly powerful screening, and I mean, even George Bezos, his lawyer, is there, you know. And some of the comrades who were on B-Wing are there in the room. It's quite a surreal experience watching a film that you've made about those people who are actually lived. I mean, it was. But I have to say the feeling afterwards and the support and it was
just happy, or were they a little shell shocked by?
They were shell shocked. They were very moved. Very, very moved. Very moved by it. Yeah, yeah. All of them.
And we haven't really talked much about Naomi, but she kind of, like, whenever she shows up in the movie, it's like she grabs the camera and owns it for
yes.
that period of time.
And what chemistry. I mean, you imagine that these two, I mean, what you, when I was talking about it being a love story, you know, you. It's all very well, but you know that magic thing that happens on camera of just there's a kind of I don't know, some inexplicable thing why two people just come together. Just Naomi and Idris, they had a chemistry that just worked. I mean, they're only really, I think, together for about 7 or 8 minutes in the film, you know. But that had to be the heart of the film, because that was what the film was. You know, that was the core of the movie, but they just had this energy together, and Naomi is extraordinary. I mean, you know, like Idris, she was walking into worlds where, you know, in that church scene, for example, where she gives that speech about what they're going to do with traitors, what they're going to do with informers, what they're going to do with their own fists and with boxes of matches and petrol. You know, Naomi's in the middle of Soweto in a church where these events happened with people who are living it. So yeah, she's quite extraordinary. I knew she was because we'd both been in Kenya together, and part of that is that we both had to be these kids had never seen a moving image that we're working with in such a remote area that these unbelievably bright children had not seen a moving image, so they didn't care about making a movie, you know. All they wanted was to me and Naomi to be a teacher, you know. And so they would just call me Teacher Justin and Naomi Teacher Jane, because that was the character she was playing. So I knew that she'd get in amongst it and roll up her sleeves and be in it. But what was very exciting was that these two people who had done a certain amount of work beforehand, but came with very little baggage, just bam, clicked. They just, from the very first scenes that they were together, it was just like, you put the camera, and it's 35mm, so you're kind of, oh my goodness, you feel the heat between these two. And that was exciting. That was really exciting to feel. I knew both of them were great, subtle, honest actors, but just that chemistry between the two of them, that was really very exciting to be around.
Were you believe from the beginning to the end of the movie that she could own his soul?
Yeah, yeah.
Which is
yeah
part of it.
Yeah, that's right.
So is it strange now? I mean, you have first grader got a lot of love, but not a huge number of eyeballs.
Yeah, well, this is why it's so difficult in modern cinema for independent movies to kind of get anywhere. I mean, you know, which is why it's a great year for film. There are some brilliant, brilliant movies out in the cinema at the moment and have been out. First Grader. It went all around the world with all the, you know, in the film festivals, won all sorts of awards. But then you need distribution. And with Mandela, I'm just hoping that it finds a place in cinema, because I think you know, it's a film to be experienced in the cinema.
So do you feel the energy that's coming as the distribution is ramping up?
And who knows? I don't know. I mean, I don't know. All I want to do is my best, you know, and mm-hmm. and I think it's a piece of cinema to be seen in the cinema. We shot it on 35mm. It's got great action. It's epic as well as it's kind of intimate, and it's visceral and emotional, and it should be enjoyed in the movie theatres. But it's so hard. It's so hard, as you know. You know, now your film can open on a Friday and be out the door on the Sunday or Monday. You know, so it's all about your distributor. It's all about getting it in there and whether it clicks with an audience. So, what can I say? I mean, I hope and pray for it, and I'll be there trying to promote it and do what I can, because I totally believe in the movie, and I think it's a movie to stand in there with, up against the CGI movies and the movies about the superheroes. You know, I really do.